Hey everyone, welcome to the New Trust Economy. I'm Tracy Hazard.
And I'm Monika Prophet.
And we are excited to come back to you. And Monika, you just got back from a big trip to Puerto Rico.
Oh yeah, I was just there for a huge financial summit that just was over the top and knocked out all of these different summits and trade shows I've been to just out of the park. It was absolutely incredible. And then I even extended my trip for an extra day just to get a little bit of time in, you know, at the beach. So it was all work for like six straight days. And then on the seventh day, I rested.
There you go. You know, I think this is so interesting for us to talk about all of these summits and trade shows and events that are going on, because this blockchain and cryptocurrency space is so vibrant and so full of energy and events. And so as we're looking to that, it's how do we decide which ones are going to be good? And I mean, you didn't know that ahead of time, but it turned out to be amazing. So,
oh my gosh, yeah.
I think we have to talk about this more so that we can really kind of get people to go, this is one I don't want to miss next time, or this one looks like it's going to be good and here's how I might be able to tell. So let's talk a little bit about why this event was so good.
Well, for me, it was so good because it was capped. The attendance was capped. It was not like four or 500 people. It was 120, very specifically selected. So all of the connections.
What was it called?
It was the Kinetic International Financial Summit. So it was
cool, Nate.
Yeah. And they're the only international bank in Puerto Rico. So it was a really, it was a private event. It was, we had the charter house rules, you know, nothing. We can't really talk about who was there or what we talked about, but it was fantastic and a very, very useful summit. I found that getting into more exclusive events is worth the investment and it's worth the time, especially if you're invited versus you're paying. But even to pay to invest in your network has been a huge part of my financial success has been, you know, you are the average of the five people you spend the most time with. And I think you're probably the average in your year of the five summits that you go to. So you better choose wisely.
Yeah, that's such a good point. You know, I think I have the same experience that the events that are under 200 people are much more valuable at the end of the day. You yeah. have more opportunity to meet people. And I find even some of the ones that I've done that are under 50 have just yep. been absolutely amazing in terms of connecting with people and having time for that. And I think that that's one of the things that I value most in an event, in a summit or an event style or a mastermind even, is that as long as there's time to sit and communicate with each other, like when you're running an event and you've got all these speakers and then everybody's out in the hall because they left no time for networking, I can't stand that. That drives me absolutely crazy.
And unfair. It's not even networking at some point. You know, it's like, it's just, you're running from like content, you're drinking from a fire hose, but there's no time to actually metabolize that and do anything with it. So this was like very little fire hose, a lot of communicating. And I've even found that some events where they have intentionally, hey, let's go do the sound bath meditation or totally completely unrelated thing ends up being the place where you can make those more genuine connections.
Oh, now you're talking my speed. At one of my favorite events that I've ever done, there was only 10 of us and there was a sound bath meditation, which I totally loved.
Right. Yeah. The sound bath thing, it works for everybody.
You know? I don't know why. It's amazing. Yeah. So if you guys aren't familiar with that, it is like so cool. Go look it up, find one in your area, check it out and try it because it's just worth immersing.
It's so much fun.
Something fun and different. Yeah. Yeah. So, but yeah, I agree. So I think that that's something I look for. Now, you know, I was talking with Alon Gorin because there's going to be an interview that I'll publish before this episode that we're recording here. And he was talking about the CIS show. And they have two shows that run in conjunction with each other. One where it's much more intimate, invite only, and it happens the day before. And it's really focused on investors and startups that might be considering investment and starting to kind of get advice. And then the next day is really all for CIS. It's like, you know, 1,000 people. It's like, you know, huge and one of the biggest shows there is out here on in California. And so, you know, that's where I was like, I just want the invite to the smaller one. I'll check out the other one and write about it in, you know, in my column or something. But I don't see that, you know, I know I'll find something interesting there, but it's a lot more work to find something interesting at these big events.
I agree. I totally agree. Yeah, I can't really do big events anymore. Also, big events, I get so overwhelmed that I literally have to budget in time just to go back to the hotel room and be away from people just to recharge for a minute. And that's not, I don't even think that's an introverted thing. It's just, it's too overwhelming when there's thousands of people and there's no way that one human being with two eyes, a nose, and one mouth, two ears can take in and get out all the things that could be done with all those people. So it's exciting beyond capacity. And I don't find it even helpful at all anymore.
Yeah. So, you know, there's this trend going on of like, oh, let's put a bunch of celebrities at our event and bring people in. And what do you think of that? Like, and that'll attract people to, you know, come in and consume our information.
Well, I mean, whether it's about consumer information or not, celebrities are the conduit for a B2C play, right? Celebrities bring in the C. And when people go, oh my gosh, Miley Cyrus was at Art Basel, Miami. Art Basel, Miami attendance went up, you know? Did the real valuable people not find value there anymore? I think that also was true eventually, and it wore itself out. Yeah. So in some ways, you know, B2B is where you usually are playing when you're at a trade show. B2C, not so much. And so putting your attention on the consumer direct via the celebrity interest is kind of it's a distraction. Although I can see how it could bring in more higher ticket sales, which is, I think, in the end, where the conference coordinators and their interests are not really aligned with their own people that they're serving at some point.
Well, you know, it's an interesting play from a press perspective. So because I write a column, so I'm usually invited to events to cover events. And the bigger the celebrity is, they're like, oh, you should be totally excited to write about this. And I'm like, no, not so much. No, you know, I mean, it's like, it's not my beat. I'm not an entertainment writer. And so they don't seem to understand that. So, you know, it's an interesting dynamic that they think, oh, well, you know, that'll be great for your column to be writing. So I just,
not so much.
Colin Farrell. And wow, I have to say the most articulate celebrity I have yet interviewed.
Wow.
Which is saying a lot. So, he was very, very articulate and interesting. You know, it's the application to my column and to business on that side, you know, he doesn't even consider himself an entrepreneur or a business. So like, wow. How does that apply? Well, you know, it's a big stretch to get inspiration from that. And that's about all it is. And I don't write an inspiration column. I write a how-to. I write, you know, figure out how to do this, bootstrap it, right? And so it's just not a play. And I don't think that the event coordinators always understand that. And so if you want to attract the media, is really going to write about the nitty gritty of what's going on at your event and who's there and who's worth, you know, taking a look at and how I can be of service to the, you know, the people. So sometimes there's trade shows in conjunction with an event. And so you talk about like vendors in a way or sponsors and how can, you know, they get exposure. Well, you want the right press there. And so that celebrity play doesn't always work really well either.
Yeah, so, I agree 100%.
So what's some of your criteria as you're going through and like looking at the events that are coming up, like why should I be there?
Well, I no longer do international travel unless they're paying me as a speaker or a moderator or a panelist. I just don't do it. They have to be getting my travel and accommodations. Otherwise I'm not seeing a value. It's just too expensive. The lift is too heavy.
Well, what about if you were an attendee? What would you think? You know, what would you think?
So I attended Web Summit for the first time last year, and I actually was really underwhelmed. The programming was fantastic, but it was just too big. It was too much, and it just wasn't my speed. I mean, I ended up basically hanging out with the same crew that I already knew, and we did the things. We stayed together, and that's just kind of normal social dynamics. So it just was not the kind of scale that served me, and I left going, I am done with big conferences. In fact, I'm done with the strategy of go meet strangers. If I don't meet people that are already sort of friends, it's the network is not actually going to grow. It's just going to be more business cards to process. I mean, the stack of business cards, you know, this is like one of three. They're just sitting there.
I'm done. Like, this is like this is just this year. So this is
done.
The first 3 months of the year, first 2.5 months of the year. So,
and I don't have it. Like if it wasn't a meaningful conversation, then it's not going to be now. The follow-up is going to be weird. It's going to be a template. They're going to get on my mailing list. They won't appreciate it.
Yeah.
So there's just no value out there. I just go smaller, the better. And even if it's more expensive, I would rather do three really, really meaningful, small, well-curated events than anything big again.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. You know, I like to attend events that do three things. So I like to attend events that expand my mind. So sometimes I will reach out into new areas and new communities, which is how I ended up coming into the blockchain world because, someone was really pushing me saying, you should be there. This is going to be very cool. And there was application for what I could write about. So I was like, okay, that makes sense. And, but it was, I knew it would expand my mind. And so that is really important to me that I do make it sure that I attend events, but I try to attend events that are within to check it out, you know,
yeah,
within,
right,
within a certain radius. So that was Las Vegas. It's a 4.5 hour drive, you know, not a big deal, or short, you know, cheap flight. Like I'm going to do that, or I'll go into an area like, you know, Austin, where I have clients and network already. So at least, right, I can do more than one thing while I'm there. And so, yeah, so that's one of the things I try to do. At least I try to do that about 2 to 3 times a year. Because yep, I want to make sure that I'm always growing myself. And so that's one thing. Then I like the smaller events. So I look for the ones where there really is going to be the right type of audience. They're at the right level. They're advanced enough. It's going to grow me there. And that might be 50 people or less, right?
Right.
In that area. And so it really is about deep networking in those kinds of things. And then we do 2 large trade shows a year, but
you have to, cause you've got some consumer facing product that you have.
I have consumer facing. Right. And right. So those are the only times that we do that, but we're sponsors. So we're about to be at Podfest, and Podfest is like 1,000+ podcasters who come to that and try to grow and expand.
Oh, that's cool.
We're badge sponsors, so like our name's on the little, you know, thing that the little chain
out of it,
right? Whatever that is, they named a room after us, right? And so, like, and then there's speaking going on, so like those things are important to us. But now I agree with you, like I don't do international without being paid to speak. So if
I'm also, I mean, as an entrepreneur, where I could be on the attendee side, or I could be on the speaking side, or I could be on the sponsor side, because people are always pitching to a startup person, oh, come sponsor this, and I'm like, I have not paid for a single sponsorship yet, and I just don't. I think as a, you know, the person who's like on that, in that founder position, where I'm like right between having the budget to go and, you know, get our name out, and then, and oh, but you have to pay money to make money, and here's your access to investors. I just don't buy it ever.
No. And I think like we wouldn't have sponsored this year if we hadn't gone last year and said, okay, this is a worthwhile event. It's got big enough and it's got qualified people.
Yep.
It's worth going to. And we also established a relationship with the organizers and the founder. And so we know that it's valuable. Right. And so I think that's where we too quickly get an email and sign up for something and, you know, like, oh, I'm going to go to this thing. And you're like, you know what? Did you even check out who's running this?
Yeah.
Right. I think that that's like more of the play that has to happen as you're looking for what should I go to. And so, you know, this is in the crypto and blockchain space, most of the local meetups, and I check them out because that has like how I met Alon Gorin. He was speaking there and he was fantastic and he was connection to a bigger network. But you know, for most of them, they're sponsored by lawyers.
Yep.
By securities attorneys, by firms that are selling you something. And that's where these meetups are. And for the most part, I find them just all sales. And so you have to really sit through that and go, do I really need to waste my time doing this again and again and again?
Yep.
Or am I getting something valuable?
I mean, I have had great luck at the local meetups that are here in New York City. They've been fantastic. But then again, we're at the epicenter of fintech. So to talk with people, yes, there are lawyers around, but a lot of lawyers here are still getting up to speed on it. And they're like, well, we think so. We're not sure. Don't want to say anything I can't say, you know? So because of that conservatism, the people that know crypto are actually the ones that are usually on stage, the ones that are talking. I speak at them sometimes, and it's great because it means that we can bring value and bring attention to what we need our attention to be brought to, like our own endeavors for me and my own book or whatever. So that works out really well. And I found some amazing connections. I mean, that's how I got to the Financial Summit, was that I'm in Puerto Rico, was that I met somebody at a blockchain meetup during Blockchain Week. And I just, you know, started talking to him, and one of the evening, and also the daytime stuff, not so much. I don't need to learn more about blockchain. I wrote the book. It's fine. I need to
But there are some of our listeners who really do. So, you know, that's the thing. It's like, you do have to balance that if that's what your goal is.
Well, that's the thing. Are we talking about conferences to learn at, or are we talking about conferences to network at? Because the networking all happens at night for me. And I think consistently it always does. So I just skip the daytime stuff. I sometimes don't even get the ticket, but I'll go and I'll be around, and then I go to all the lounges. And if I can't get into the actual event, I just go and hang out at the restaurant bar, and all the people that are having downtime where you actually get to talk to them and make a connection, that's where you get it there. So if you have a bootstrapping, you're going to bootstrap and hack the conference approach, just go and hang out at the bar.
That just happened to me at a recent event. I met some of the most interesting people at dinner and at the bar.
Yep.
So, yeah, exactly. So, you know, yeah, that's so true. That is really it. You know, but I think there are a lot of people who are looking for what is the best place for me to get good information. And I think that's something you have to actually vet. So if it's a brand new event, you know, go there with that skepticism in mind. And if it's not a brand new event, go ask some people who've been before.
Yeah, definitely.
Go look up some of the older speakers. So if you, a lot of them will have their speakers from last year, go check them out and say, well, hey, would I want to hear someone like that?
Yeah.
Usually their videos are on YouTube. So their past speeches are, they usually air them and share them afterwards as part of their promo. So, you know, that's important to check them out as well. So I just did Larry King, which was super exciting. And so, it was really Larry asking questions about like, what is this blockchain and cryptocurrency stuff? And what do you think, Tracy? And yeah. This is just like, I grew up listening to him live, right? And he's still doing it. And it's so amazing, right? I mean, he's just still doing it. So, but the response back that I've gotten so far was really what's most interesting. And the response back that we've been getting online and in social media and in the emails on our show here is that we're nicely treading the line between making sure that we're keeping them up on the deeper understanding. Do I get this? Or am I missing out on this? Do I not have a fundamental understanding? And we're giving them a real world perspective. Like, is this working? Is this going to be applied rather than just like talking all tech? And
right.
So I'm proud of us for that. So I think that we're doing good service here, and we'd like to do more of that. So keep reaching out to us. You know, new Trust Economy listeners, we want to serve you well. So please reach out to us. What types of things would you like us to dive deeper in? We were just talking before that we're going to dive a little bit deeper into what's going on in Wyoming for corporation formations and cryptocurrency holdings and banks that are going on there. And let's find out what's really going on there. And you know, and we'll give you our perspective and thoughts about it based on our experiences.
Absolutely. That sounds great. I can't wait to.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, and then we had a little hiccup with someone who was in trouble, who we interviewed on our show. You want to talk a little bit about it? Because I hate to leave that hanging out there and people are like, what the heck happened?
I actually, you know, I was really surprised that there was any trouble there, but we did interview somebody who, it looks like there's been, you know, I think the crypto space is changing so quickly. And fintech changes so quickly and startups change so quickly that it's very easy to end up in the crosshairs of somebody through a bad business deal or just someone who disagrees with you. So I don't know if it's something you want to bring more attention to or less.
Well, you know, so we were reached out by a listener or a viewer on YouTube, actually, that Lisa Loud, your interview that you did with Lisa Loud, is that she's up on some securities fraud charges. And so we have not done some background research yet to really fully dive into it because Monica's been gone and so it just happened. And so we'll dive a little bit deeper and try to find out that and add some information to the bottom of the blog post. So if things like that happen, what we want you to understand is that if it gets really bad, like if she's, you know, convicted or something like that, we will pull our episodes. Because
we can pull them, or we can always just follow up with them and say, here's the rest of what we found out and look at how the process goes, because there's even more value in that, I think.
Right. Absolutely. And that's what I think what we'll do is we would pull it from the main feed so people aren't running through it first. And instead you'll have the follow-up episode and you'll be able to reference the old episode and hear it. So we'll do something like that in the future. But for right now, we don't have a lot of information on what happened exactly. But there is a lot of this going on. So just keep this in mind. And sometimes it's just a crackdown. Like, you know, they got caught in a net of everything. And sometimes it's a legitimate closure, right? It's legitimate. They're shutting them down for securities reasons. So we're going to try to find out more about that and follow up with Lisa and see what's going on there. And so we'll definitely at minimum put a caveat at the bottom of the blog post. But we will look at doing a future episode and figuring this out. Because, I mean, our job here is to expose you. It is not to make judgment.
Well, I also think, I mean, this is just something that I've run into as an advisor of many companies, is someone will say, I see that you're an advisor of X company. They're terrible. And they're in the middle of a lawsuit and they did this and that. And others, and it's like, they're just trolling me.
Yeah. And so we have to be careful with that. And so that just to let you know, though, that when we see those things, we don't shut them down. We take a look at them. We say, is there something here that we need to make you aware of? And we will do that.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, you know, but we're also not professional journalists here. So like, I mean, this is a show, it's our part-time gig. And so just keep in mind that we don't have the same vetting and journalistic practices that a, you know, newspaper should have, right? This is a podcast.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we're raising attention and awareness to someone that came across us, and we thought, wow, there's something interesting here to discuss. And that something interesting may not go away even if their business went away.
Right, exactly.
So anyway, just wanted to make you listeners aware of what's going on out there. And we'll keep you posted on what we find.
Yeah, absolutely. For sure. Any other things that you want to talk about in this particular episode, or should we do a separate one just for Wyoming? I don't know.
Yeah, let's just do a separate one for Wyoming. We're gonna bring on someone who's a professional in that, who's been lobbying and been doing all of the things to try to make sure that the laws are crypto friendly, as it's been termed. Me in Wyoming. So I think that's going to be coming up soon. But we'd love to hear more from you guys. What do you want to hear about? What can we bring to you? What kind of experiences can we go out there while we're at these events and these trade shows and these summits and find people for us to interview for you, or find information on things that you've never heard before? That's your job, is to give us some feedback here so we can help you.
Yeah, definitely. Let us know what you're interested in and we will go and sleuth it out.
Sounds really good. Well, Monika, I'm so glad you had a great trip, and you got to rest up, and we're going to be headed to, hopefully, we're going to keep our fingers crossed that South by Southwest is still happening.
I'm going to be there for sure. I just, some of our accommodations might be iffy. We'll see.
Yeah,
we're going to see each other at the podcast meetup.
That's right. So we'll see each other at least at a podcast meetup, and hopefully we'll be able to do some South by Southwest New Trust Economy episodes from there.
Yes,
and
awesome.
Hopefully the Crypto Vixens. That's all going to happen, right?
Yeah.
So let's talk Crypto Vixen soon. So, you know, some things are going to be coming up. So stay tuned for those episodes. Until next time, this is Tracy and Monika on the New Trust Economy.
Thanks, you guys.